who is on a bended knee, and we will ask Sister Helena to please pray.
Our Father in heaven, we thank you for all the wonderful things you've done for us, and for all the best blessings you bestow upon us. Be merciful and gracious to us, Father. Forgive us for our sins and shortcomings. We thank you for giving us this opportunity on your special holy Sabbath day to come together to worship you and to study your word. Help us, Father, to learn. Help us, Father, to study together, that we may come closer to you, that we may prepare for Christ's second coming. Please, Father, we invite your holy angels to come among us, to be with us, to help us, to guide us, to protect us. We ask that you may be especially with the youth and the children, that they may prepare, that we may know what is ahead, and that we may be ready when Christ comes again. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Welcome everyone, and now the children's program, and this is for the children in Queensland and Toronto.
God sent his angel.
song. So it's nice to hear you sing, and thank you, Sienna, for that verse. It's a very important verse for us to remember. So, from the children singing, who can guess what this today's young people's meeting is about? Well, every single song was about angels. So is that a bit of a hint? Who can tell me what this young people's meeting is about?
Ministry of angels.
That's right. It's about the ministry of angels and about angels watching over us and about angels in general, actually. So to tell us more about angels in the Bible, we're going to ask Brother Doran to come up, and he's going to speak to us.
So good afternoon. Blessed Sabbath, everyone. I hope this topic will keep awake children and the youth and all of us. I'd like to talk a little bit about angels in the Bible, because we have angels all over the Bible. You know, the Bible stories about angels, and many of you children and youth, you remember some of the Bible stories, right? So we are going to go through some of them. And just remember, this is one of them when the angels were involved in saving someone, or in this case, it was closing the mouth or the mouths of the lions when Daniel was thrown in the lion's den. Just before I mention some other examples, there is a book written by Sister White. It's a compilation. It's called The Truth About Angels. So these are paragraphs from Sister White writings. Very powerful, very interesting book. Actually, it's a good book for families, for children. Just take it when you say it, buy it, and you can have your devotionals. You know, it's not long chapters, but it goes on topics. Angels in Eden, angels in the time of Enoch, angels in the time of Jesus Christ, and angels in the last days, you know. And it's a good book you can have for your family, just to let you know. So the first thing I'd like to mention about angels, and boys and girls, this is where, yeah, who can help me? Yeah, from that side, Nicholas, Jacob, Justin, you know this story. Who is in this picture? Do you remember? Okay, one of you, please. Maya was first, go ahead. Adam and Eve, yes. And what is that behind them with the sword? Okay, Nicholas? Okay, protecting what? Oh, the garden, right? Yes, I didn't hear. Yeah, that's true. So we read in Genesis 3:24, the Bible says, when Adam and Eve have sinned, you know, before the fall, angels used to come and communicate with Adam and Eve. This was very common. This was God is speaking to them. And angels would come. Can you imagine angels coming to talk with you? This would be something, right? We even can't imagine that. But that was before the fall. And so after the fall, what happens? We see that Genesis 3:24, so he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. So some of the children, they said that they were protecting the tree of life, and that is true, right? Because Adam and Eve, they ate from the tree of knowledge and of good and evil, and now God had to protect the tree of life. This is in the Bible account what we read. So we see they are kicked out from the Garden of Eden. They lost their privilege. And the angel is there protecting, right? Bible also, and the inspiration says that they used to come. They used to come very close, but they couldn't get in. You know, the angels was protecting. Now, some of the youth, do you know for how long the Garden of Eden was on the earth? For how many years after after Adam and Eve? After the fall, how many years?
After 100 years.
How many? No, for how long? I mean, like, what was the? Yeah, I know. I see some of the brethren. I like some of the youth. I know you know. So until when? There is a point in human history when the Garden of Eden was taken. Okay, I see Rhoda. Go ahead.
The flood?
Yes. Yeah, before the flood, actually I think it's Tetrarchs and Prophets, it says that the Garden of Eden was removed, right? So then no more angels protecting the Tree of Life, because the Garden of Eden was removed, and it is going to be restored again after 1,000 years, when Jesus comes with the Holy City. So Patriarchs and Prophets, page 62, the Garden of Eden remained upon the earth long after man had become an outcast from its pleasant paths. The fallen race were long permitted to gaze upon the home of innocence, their entrance barred only by the watching angels. Very interesting. Now, another personality we often talk is who walked with God. We call him, what is his name? Okay, may I get Caleb. What is what's the name of this man who walked with God? Enoch, you know, yes. So Enoch, the Bible says he walked with God for a few hundred years, and after he was ruptured, or he was translated, yes, to heaven. Okay, so here we have one paragraph. Enoch learned from the lips of Adam the painful story of the fall and the precious story of God's condescending grace and the gift of his Son as the world's Redeemer. He believed and relied upon the promise given. Enoch was a holy man. He served God with singleness of heart. He realized the corruptions of the human family and separated himself from the descendants of Cain and reproved them for their great wickedness. His soul was vexed as he daily beheld them trampling upon the authority of God. He chose to be separate from them and spend much of his time in solitude, giving himself to reflection and prayer. He waited before God and prayed to know his will more perfectly, that he might perform it. How did God communicate with Enoch? God communed with Enoch through his angels and gave him divine instruction. He made known to him that he would not always bear with man and his rebellion, that it was his purpose to destroy the sinful race by bringing a flood of waters upon the earth. So God communicated with Enoch. How was this communication done? What was the bridge in between God and Enoch? Through his angels. So we see angels involved in this part of his life. Okay, we'll skip this one. Angels of God that excel in strength are sent to minister to those who shall be heirs of salvation. These angels, when they see that we are doing the very utmost on our part to be overcomers, will do their part, and their light will shine around about us and sway back the influence of the evil angels that are around us, and will make a fortification around us as a wall of fire. This is from Review and Herald, April 19, 1870. Powerful paragraph, right? So we are in between two powers, right? The angels of light and the angels of darkness. The good angels and the evil angels. So we see that God will send. When we cooperate with God, angels will be on our side. You know, there are many stories. This is not my topic, but many stories when somebody said, well, I was going to do this and I was going to harm, but there was something like a light protecting that person. There was something, you know, and this child, you know, something like, now let's put it in different words. Like you are driving, right? And all of a sudden we are distracted. You know, we are very much distracted in these days. You know, somebody's on the phone and this is illegal, right? But we are doing something, and all of a sudden you see that you are almost to get into an accident or something, right? And then all of a sudden you steered your wheel or whatever. So I believe that the holy angels are to assist us. They saved us. They saved children. They saved youth and all of us. You know, when we are in, we say like a power, like something. You know, just came and changed the whole thing. So these are the angels. Now I'd like again the youth, children actually, Who can tell me who is this hero here in the Bible? Okay, some of you children, do you recognize this this hero with three strangers? Who the Bible says that this man, being very hospitable. Okay, Jacob, go ahead.
Abraham,
thank you. Yes, Abraham. This is Abraham. He didn't know, but he entertained angels. He didn't know these were just strangers to him. This is from Truth About Angels. God conferred great honor upon Abraham. Angels of heaven walked and talked with him as friend with friend. Wow, again, right? So this was the privilege of Enoch. This is another patriarch. What's his name? Some of the children from that side, what is the name of this patriarch? Jenny? Very good. So I'm just checking if you are paying attention. I know you are. So here is a short paragraph about what happened. In the hot summer noontide, the patriarch was sitting in his tent door looking out over the quiet landscape when he saw in the distance three travelers approaching. Before reaching his tent, the strangers halted as if consulting as to their course. Without waiting for them to solicit favors, Abraham rose quickly, and as they were apparently turning in another direction, he hastened after them and with the utmost courtesy urged them to honor him by tearing for refreshment. With his own hands, he brought water that they might wash the dust of travel from their feet. He himself selected their food, and while they were at rest under the cooling shade, an entertainment was made ready, and he stood respectfully beside them while they partook of his hospitality. Isn't this beautiful? So he doesn't know three strange people, you know, approach his close to his tent, and he rushes, you know, he runs and he says, "Gentlemen, would you like to maybe have a drink and maybe get some refreshment? Just stop by." They are kind of like, we don't know, you know, they were testing Abraham, right? So, but this was his test as well. So he was very hospitable. He opened his door was open for people, and this way he didn't know who are these people. So continuing, Abraham had seen in his guests only three tired wayfarers, little thinking that among them was one whom he might worship without sin. See, this is only, the inspiration tells us this element. In the Bible, we read that these were three strangers, and we know that these were the three heavenly messengers, right? But the inspiration tells us, in this paragraph says, one of them he could worship without sin. Who was that one? Now, you know, children, who was that one whom he could worship without sin? Okay? Who was that one? You know, Jacob. We can worship and do not sin. Who is the one we can worship and we will not sin? There is one. Yes. Thank you. That was Jesus. That was Christ himself. You know, he came with the other two angels they were in a special mission. But the true character of the heavenly messengers was now revealed. Though they were on their way as ministers of wrath, yet to Abraham, the man of faith, they spoke first of blessings. You know, sometimes somebody comes to you and says, "Well, I have two news for you. One is bad and one is good. Which one do you want first?" And we think for a couple of minutes and say, "Well, tell me first the good news." So that's what happened. These angels, they were on a mission to bring a bad news, right? That Sodom and Gomorrah is going to be destroyed. But before that, they had a good news. And the good news was what? Who remembers? Those of you in Toronto last Sabbath, we preached about that good news. What was the good news? What they brought to Abraham? He's going to have a child, a baby boy, right? So that was the good news. And what's interesting that it was fulfilled. By the way, you see three strangers. One of them was Christ, two angels, right? You have to know that Christ didn't go to Sodom. Only the two angels. If you read carefully, you'll notice that only the two angels, they left and they went. Christ case specifically for Abraham. This is wonderful, you know. And so two of them, now we talk about the angels being bringing this bad news to the people of Sodom. So we have Lot. Some of you have heard the story of Lot and his escape. What do we see in Lot? What do you see similar in between Lot and Abraham? What did he do as well when these strangers came to the gate of Sodom? What did he do? Did he let them stay in the street, or did he tell them, well, there is a good motel here, you can go there, or I can pay your motel? No. What did he say? Well, come in, right? Go ahead, Jacob. He invited them over. Very good. Yes, he invited them over. He didn't know these are angels. You know, in those days, we didn't have like iPhones and cell phones, right? Say, Abraham gives a call to Lot, hey, listen, somebody is coming to you, right? So watch out, these are angels, right? No communication like that. This is no kidding, right? So no communication. He didn't send any messenger to inform him. So didn't have a clue. A Lot was also hospitable because he learned it from Abraham. And at the same time, he accepted two angels. And you know the story, I'm not going to go into lots of details, but you know the story, what happened, right? When the people of Sodom saw these strange people, these strangers, not strange, these strangers, sorry about that, we know what they wanted to do, right? And if not of the power of God, of the angels, they were ready even to kill Lot because he didn't let them do whatever they wanted. So we know the power of the angels, what they did in the Old Testament. Now another one, I have many stories to go through, so just to remind that the power and the work and the ministry of the angels with us. So Jacob and the angel. So Jacob had many instances when he was, either he had a dream and he saw many angels going up and down, or in other circumstances. But in this particular case, actually this was again Christ. Now to clarify something for everybody, for children specifically and youth, in the Bible sometimes when he said this was the angel of the Lord and that was Christ, because in the three strangers who came to Abraham, one was Christ. But Christ also is called the archangel. So the angel means a messenger. So Christ is also a messenger, although we have to make the difference that Christ is not created. And he is the creator of the angels and the cherubims and the seraphims and all the creation at all. So here he says the fight in between the angel and Jacob, right? So he didn't let him go. He said, unless you bless me, I'll not let you go. He hit him on his thigh, but he didn't let him. And finally, he was blessed. It's amazing, you know. Jacob learned his lesson. He came so humbly, you know, to this. Let's go further. It says it was Christ, the angel of the covenant, who had revealed himself to Jacob. The patriarch was now disabled and suffering the keenest pain, but he would not loosen his hold. He must have the assurance that his sin was pardoned. The angel tried to release himself. He urged, let me go, for the day breaketh. But Jacob answered, I will not let thee go, except thou bless me. Had this been a boastful, presumptuous confidence, Jacob would have been instantly destroyed. But his was the assurance of one who confesses his own unworthiness, yet trusts the faithfulness of a covenant-keeping God. Jacob had power over their angel and prevailed. Wonderful. Now, let's move on. A few more slides. Who can tell me? Zachary, do you know this story? Who is in this picture? Yeah, his friends. You remember their names? Yeah, they had... Very good. Yes, very good. Yes, this is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Very good, Zachary, yes. So we know the story, right? What happened with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? They didn't want to worship the image, right, which Nebuchadnezzar built in Babylon. And as a circumstance, the king said, well, you worship or you are going to die. And they said, whatever king you want to do, we are not going to worship. So they were thrown in the fiery furnace. So who came? Prophets and Kings, page 513, it says, as in the days of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, so in the closing period of Earth's history, the Lord will work mightily in behalf of those who stand steadfastly for the right. So at one moment, the king noticed how many people are in the fiery furnace. So he put in the fiery furnace how many?
Three.
And now how many, Rhoda?
Four.
Four. Who is the fourth one? Who was the fourth one? Caleb, go ahead.
Jesus,
yes. Again, you know, Jesus himself came to save, you know. This was very confusing for the people who was that one, and they were taken out, and this was a great testimony for those people. So we see that Jesus himself and his angels, they were in the mission, you know, to protect. This is another story we had in the first slide. Is Daniel where? Jacob? Lion's Den. Beloved story of children, right? Daniel and the Lion's Den. Very good. So it's unbelievable. Now you just come close and this is big trouble. In those days, he was amongst the lions. And they were walking like two cats, right? So we would walk with cats, right? So nothing happened. Why? Because the angel of the Lord was there. He was protected. Now, just a couple slides about Jesus Christ and the angels in his ministry. There are many instances when Christ was protected, where Christ was helped by the angels. So these are just few. This is from Science of the Times, September 3rd, 1900. It says, all heaven watched the conflict between the Prince of Light and the Prince of Darkness. Angels stood ready to interpose in Christ's behalf should Satan pass the prescribed limit. You know, God allows certain times, you know, that Satan would tempt, would try, you know, because he says, well, this is why, because you protect them. This is because you blessed Job, and that's why he is faithful. Just give me a little bit this guy, and I will, I'll prove you that he is going to turn around, and he will rebel against you. Well, that was not the case. So in this case, Christ was tempted in the wilderness. And Satan was, this was a very tough time. But the angels of the Lord didn't let the evil angels to come too close to that boundary which they were permitted to come. And there was a point that they couldn't pass. So then, this is also a paragraph. After Satan had ended his temptations, he departed from Jesus for a season. And angels prepared him food in the wilderness. Very interesting. You don't read that every day, right? So Christ was tired. He was hungry. He didn't transform the stone, the rock into bread. But after the temptation, it says that Satan withdrew for a season, for some time. And who prepared him food? There is not Mary. There is not none of, you know, close people. These were the angels. As in the time of Elijah, if you remember, right? The angel came, you know, was waking him up. Hey, wake up, eat something, drink some water, right? The same with Jesus. Angels prepared him food. This is when Lazarus was resurrected, Desire of Ages, 5:35. Christ could have commanded the stone to remove, and it would have obeyed his voice. He could have bidden the angels who were close by his side to do this. At his bidding, invisible hands would have removed the stone, but it was to be taken away by human hands. Thus Christ would show that humanity to cooperate with divinity, what human power can do, divine power is not summoned to do. Very interesting in Christ's ministry. So the angels, they were powerful, right? For them, there is nothing impossible. They, you know, just one word and they would be right there, you know, to remove the stone. No, but Christ said, told to those people, hey, remove the stone. The Lazarus has to come out, right? So, very, very interesting paragraph as well. The angels also, they took part in the resurrection. And when Christ was buried in that sepulcher, right? So the angels were watching over the sepulcher. The angel of the Lord came in the morning, Sunday morning, and called him up, says, your father calls you, wake up, and Christ came to life. They're very interesting, you know, the whole thing. And then when Mary Magdalene came, who was the one? She thought it's the gardener. That was the angel of the Lord. So we see angels everywhere. We should not be afraid. We should cooperate, and the angel of the Lord will be on our side. Another great story from the Bible, children know it. The deliverance of Peter and John from prison. You know, they were put in prison for preaching about Jesus Christ. And then this was in the night. And all of a sudden, you know, this light, this power comes, releases their chains and everything, and they are released. It says, get out. You know, the door opens. They got out. And then the rulers and the priests, they were puzzled. They were just confused. How this happened? You know, everything is closed. Everything is there. And they disappear. Satan triumphed, and the evil angels exalted. But the angels of God were sent and opened the prison doors. And contrary to the command of the high priest and elders, bade them go into the temple and speak all the words of his life, of this life. Again, the angels. And this is my final thought. When you come to the last book of the Bible, which is the last book of the Bible, by the way?
Revelation.
Anyone? Okay, Caleb?
Revelation.
Very good. Revelation. Of Jesus Christ, yes. So in the last book of the Bible, we have three messages. Chapter 14, right? About the first, the second, and the third angel's messages, right? Fear God, then Babylon is fallen, and third one, do not worship the beast, and do not receive the mark of the beast. So we see that the first, the second, and first angel came one after the other, you know, bringing, proclaiming this powerful message. I think this is a tremendous truth, what we have to proclaim. And then the final one, these are the first angels. And then in Revelation chapter 18, we read verse 1 and 2. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven having great power. And the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every false spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. And then verse 4, it says, come out of her, my people. This was the voice of the angel, right? So we start in Genesis with the angels, communicated with Adam and Eve, and we finish in Revelation that when Eden, the Garden of Eden, and when man is going to be restored again, again we have the angels proclaiming this news. And just a final thought, it says that when the saints will make up to heaven and they will meet Christ, and our children, you can just imagine, everybody, you know, little children and like little angels, right? So you come, and it says that Christ will command and angels will bring the crowns to everybody who is going to be saved. This is a wonderful news for all of us. And may we keep in mind that wherever we go, whatever we do, we have to keep in mind the angel of the Lord is watching us. Everyone has got a guarding angel. So may the Lord help us. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Doran. That was very interesting. And now we have our first youth song, Lo, an Angel Love Proclaiming. So can all the youth please come?
Proclamation.
all for your participation. For those of you who don't know, this is actually the first song that was written by a Sabbath-keeping Seventh-day Adventist. So next, we will be hearing from Johnny, and he's going to be sharing with us about angels and what they did for Sister Ellen White.
So, even though all of us have guardian angels, we do not normally see them. However, during Sister White's lifetime, she is often visited by an angel, despite the fact that people around her generally are unaware of the angel's presence. On one occasion in the new year of 1881, James White picked up his ill wife, Ellen, in his arms and took her out to their waiting carriage. She was sick with a cold and could talk only in whispers. But that evening, she had a speaking appointment at the Dime Tabernacle in Battle Creek, Michigan. In the audience that evening were two college girls, Ella King and Edith Donaldson. Ella had not yet joined the Seventh-day Adventist Church, but was attending because her mother had become a member. Her friend Edith had traveled with the Whites as they had come on a long trip from Oregon to Michigan. That evening, though Edith was resentful as she saw Sister White struggle to speak in a barely audible voice, she was hanging on to the pulpit, trying to steady herself as she spoke, with only the people in the front row able to hear her. Edith felt upset towards God, who would force Ellen to strain so hard to be heard when so many prayers had been offered for her to be healed. As Edith was sitting there, she wondered to herself how she could serve such an unfair God. Try as hard as Sister White might, her message that night was just not getting through because of her illness. Suddenly, something like an electric shock went through Edith Donaldson, and she trembled all over. Then she saw a light of dazzling brightness which seemed to be entering the building through an opening in the ceiling. At the same time, Ella King's attention was attracted to the gallery window at the left nearest the pulpit, where the light moved like the waving of wings. Simultaneously, the two girls nudged each other and whispered, "An angel!" The brilliant light passed overhead directly to Sister White, who stood leaning on the pulpit. It enveloped her, and then everything in the pulpit was hidden from the sight of those two girls. They were blinded by the brightness for some moments. When they could see again, the light had vanished, and Sister White stood strong and erect at the edge of the pulpit, holding her Bible in one hand. Her voice rang out like a bell, and her first words were, "God has sent his angel and strengthened me." Helen went on speaking for over an hour in her usual stirring voice. God had healed Ellen. Later the same evening, James White asked Edith, "Did you see the angel?" She replied that she had. "Thank the Lord that he opened your eyes. He did it for a purpose," he told her. Mary, Billy's wife, and James also seen the light, as it covered Sister White. All in the congregation had seen the work of healing, but only those four were privileged to behold the brilliant demonstration. What they saw that evening, Edith and Ella could never forget. Edith felt that she had been a faithless, doubting Thomas, and that the Lord had awakened her to a new life. Both her and Ella were baptized and lived long and useful lives in the service of the Master. And on another occasion, Sister White wrote, "I was suffering with rheumatism in my left side and could get no rest because of the pain. I turned from side to side, trying to find an ease from the suffering. About 9:30, I attempted to turn myself. As I did so, I became aware that my body was entirely free from pain. As I turned from side to side and moved my hands, and I experienced an extraordinary freedom and lightness that I cannot describe. The room was filled with light and most beautiful, soft, azure light, and I seemed to be in the arms of heavenly beings. This particular light I've experienced in the past in times of special blessing, but this time it was more distinct, more impressive, and I felt such peace, peace so full and abundant, no words can express it. I raised myself into a sitting posture and I saw that I was surrounded by a bright cloud, white as snow, the edges of which were tinged with a deep pink. The softest, sweetest music was filling the air, and I recognized the music as the singing of the angels. Then a voice spoke to me, saying, Fear not, I am your Savior. Holy angels are all about you. Let us always remember these heavenly beings have one object above all others. They are working for Christ under his commission to save the uttermost who will look to him and believe in him. Sister Ellen White often found comfort in songs that breathed assurance of heavenly companionship. According to her oldest granddaughter, Ella, there was a special little chorus that was one of her grandmother's favorites. She would often hum or sing the song, Angels Hovering Round, as she went about her work during the day. Let us all always remember the holy angels are all around us. Just the same way they came to strengthen Sister White, they are more than willing to do it for us as well.
Thank you, Johnny. It's very encouraging to hear these words. And that's hymn song that you mentioned. It's our next hymn. It's called Angels Hovering Round.
Angels among us, or angels and us, angels with us. So we're talking about the relationship that angels and we have. So I have a question before I begin, for the children maybe, they're kind of scattered. So who of the children wants to tell me who is their favorite angel? I have a hand over there, okay. Justin? Gabriel, okay, that's fair. What about you, Christina? Oh, sorry, okay. Oliver? I don't think that's an angel, but that's okay. It's okay. All right, that's okay. My next question is, what angel do you think has the most influence on your life? Which angel is the most important to you individually? Maybe some children or youth can say. Okay, Justin has his hand up again. Thank you, that's right. So each of us has a guardian angel. And I think that that is probably the angel that has the most influence on you and is most important to you individually. So in Psalms 91:11 it says, "You shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways." So again, each of us has an angel that has been given to us to help us and to protect us. Okay. Now, my next question is, will our guardian angel protect us no matter what? What do you think? Any children, youth? What do you think? Will your guardian angel protect you no matter what? Justin. Sorry? Okay, sure. So Justin says yes. Who agrees with him?
God's will.
Who agrees? Okay, we have some hands. Who disagrees with him? Okay, we have some hands there. All right. So let me pose another question. What if we went to places that we shouldn't go? Will our guardian angel protect us then? I see people shaking their heads. Okay, what if we are doing things that we shouldn't be doing? Will our angel protect us then? I see some heads shaking again. Alright, so let me give you an example. If I go and I jump off a cliff and I say, it's okay, my guardian angel is going to protect me. It's fine, he will catch me. And I expect him to catch me. Here's the problem with that. I can't say yes or no. I can't say whether that my guardian angel will catch me or not. I can't say that. I won't go so far. However, if I did this, then I'm tempting the Lord. And we are warned that this is very dangerous to do.
Presumption.
Presumption, exactly. So, when our parents tell us not to go somewhere or not to do something, as children, as youth, we need to take heed and we should listen because they know what is best for us. And we should trust that if we do what is according to God's will, then our guardian angel can protect us and can help us. I would just like to read, Ellen White writes, "Every redeemed one will understand the ministry of angels in his own life. The angel who was his guardian from his earliest moment, the angel who watched his steps and covered his head in the day of peril, the angel who was with him in the valley of the shadow of death, who marked his resting place, who was the first to greet him in the resurrection morning, what will it be to hold converse with him and to learn the history of divine interposition in the individual life, of heavenly cooperation in every work for humanity?" It's beautiful, what a beautiful thought. Your guardian angel has been with you from the day you were born. In every moment, he has been there with you through everything that you have been going through. He knows you obviously better than anybody else here. But it is not just our personal guardian angels who protect us. Many, many angels of heaven come to our aid when we need it most. Angels will be especially important and engaged in the final work in the last days. Again, I would like to read, "Satanic agencies in human form will take part in this last great conflict to oppose the building up of the kingdom of God, and heavenly angels in human guise will be on the field of action. The two opposing parties will continue to exist till the closing up of the last great chapter in the world's history." So we see here that both good and bad angels, they sometimes take human guise, as it says here, to either do good or bad, however their agenda is. I was going to speak only about good angels, But I think to appreciate everything that God's angels do for us and the work they do for us, to truly appreciate it, we should mention a little bit about what the other side is doing. So if we're talking about how God's angels protect us and help us, then what are they protecting us from? So one of the things that are going to be seen in the very last days is spiritualism. And it says, spiritualism is a masterpiece of deception. It is Satan's most successful and fascinating delusion, one calculated to take hold of the sympathies of those who have laid their loved ones in the grave. Evil angels come in the form of those loved ones and relate incidents connected with their lives and perform acts which they performed while living. In this way, they lead persons to believe that their dead friends are angels, hovering over them and communicating with them. These evil angels, who assume to be the deceased friends, are regarded with a certain idolatry, and with many, their word has greater weight than the word of God. So some of you can say to me, okay, but Helena, we don't believe this clearly, we know that this is wrong, we don't hold to this. It's true. But I think all of us have a loved one that we have lost. And if it seemed like they had come back and we could talk to them and communicate with them, it's difficult, right? And I think Satan and his angels are quite powerful and they're quite convincing. So I think it's good to remind us that this is something that they can do, that's something that they will do, and perhaps do already. So this is one of the ways that Satan and his angels deceive God's people. Another way is by miracles. It says, some will be tempted to receive these words as from God. The sick will be healed before us. Miracles will be performed in our sight. Are you prepared for the trial which awaits us when the lying wonders of Satan shall be more fully exhibited? Will not many souls be ensnared and taken? So, if you're not convinced by spiritualism, then perhaps you will be tricked through these great deeds by miracles, healing or whatever it may be. So this is another way that they will ensnare, if you will. And then those who have not been deluded by spiritualism or these miracles, then what happens is that Satan and his angels will persuade mankind to persecute God's people even further. But the angels of the Lord will protect his people from these things. So God's angels will protect us to understand and discern these things, discern these false miracles, discern spiritualism when we see it, and they will protect us when we are persecuted. It says, I saw the saints leaving the cities and villages and associating together in companies and living in the most solitary places. Angels provide them food and water while the wicked were suffering from hunger and thirst. In the time of trouble, just before the coming of Christ, the righteous will be preserved through the ministration of heavenly angels, but there will be no security for the transgressor of God's law. Angels cannot then protect those who are disregarding one of the divine precepts. Well, one of the things to keep in mind is that they will not only protect us and guide us, they will work with us. So there is a work to be accomplished, and there's work for man to do, but angels are there to help man accomplish that work. It says, in the closing scenes of this earth's history, when intensity is taken possession of every earthly element, the Lord requires of us a vigilance that knows no relaxation. We are not left to struggle alone. Amid the dangers increasing on every hand, those who walk humbly before God, distrustful of their own wisdom, will have angels as their helpers and protectors. In times of special peril, they will know the power of God's keeping care. So we see here that these angels of God will be with us. They will help us. They will protect us. And will not leave us to struggle alone. I would like to read, I know that I'm reading a lot, but in putting this together, there's so many good quotations, so many good citations, so I'd like to read one more. It says, Could men see with heavenly vision, they would behold companies of angels that excel in strength, stationed about those who have kept the word of Christ's patience. With sympathizing tenderness, angels have witnessed their distress and have heard their prayers. They are waiting the word of their commander to snatch them from their peril. But they must wait a little longer. The people of God must drink of the cup and be baptized with the baptism. The very delay, so painful to them, is the best answer to their petitions. As they endeavor to wait trustingly for the Lord to work, they are led to exercise faith, hope, and patience, which have been too little exercised during their religious experience. I put this quote in specifically because I was quite touched by it. You see here how much compassion angels have for us, how devoted they are to us. But it also shows that these individuals here, they had to go through these struggles because they didn't take the time to exercise their faith, hope, and patience when it was easier to do. And so they had to go through this later when it's harder to learn these lessons.
Yeah, quotation for this.
I'm sorry, I didn't put it in here. If you ask me later, I have it written down in my notes. I would also like to say that this quotation starts with, could men see with heavenly vision? And I know that I've already read quite a lot, but I would just like to mention that I think, again, we know that angels exist, and we know that there is a controversy and war between good and evil and between these angels, and that we are a part of this war. However, somehow we get so distracted with our own lives and with things that go on that we forget that this is very much a real conflict that goes on. And I always remember Brother Horvath, how he used to say that supernatural is not a real thing. Everything that God does is natural to him because he's capable of doing everything. And so I think in many ways, you know, we think, well, because we don't see these angels, we sort of put it in the back of our minds and we forget that this is a real war that we are a part of and that we are in the midst of. And these angels really do this work. And they are either for us or against us. And it's up to us to decide which ones we want on our side and which side we need to choose. Now, as I conclude, I do want to conclude on a brighter note. So, who here can raise their hand and say that they are looking forward to Jesus coming again? I think we're all looking forward to that. But who can tell me, maybe the children, is Jesus coming alone?
No.
Zachary? No. Okay. So who's coming with him? All the angels. Thank you. The angels. I'd just like to read a couple more quotations about this. It says, soon our eyes were drawn to the east, for a small black cloud had appeared, about half as large as a man's hand, which we all knew was a sign of the Son of Man. In solemn silence, we all gazed on the cloud as it drew near, and became lighter, glorious, and still more glorious, till it was a great white cloud. The bottom appeared like fire, a rainbow was over the cloud, while around it were 10,000 angels singing a most lovely song, and upon it sat the Son of Man. With anthems of celestial melody, the holy angels, a vast unnumbered throng, attend him on his way. The firmament seems filled with radiant forms, 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands. No human pen can portray the scene. No mortal mind is adequate to conceive its splendor. Again, what a beautiful thought. And I hope that we understand that God's angels are there for us. They're there to help us. They're there to guide us and help us that one day we may witness Christ's coming with joy. I hope that we're all there one day. Amen.
Thank you, Helena. It's very important to cover these topics sometimes, and thank you for doing so now. And now we have the group singing the song, Jesus is Coming to Earth Again.
Jesus is coming to earth again.
glorious day when Jesus comes again. Up next, we have a quiz, and that's going to be presented to us by Caleb.
Good afternoon. Today I will be doing a quiz on angels. Who said, "Take heed that ye despise not one of these little ones, for I say unto you that in heaven their angels do always behold the face of my Father which is in heaven." Yes, Oliver? What was the name of the angel who told Mary she was going to have a baby? Yes, Zachary? No. Yes, Justin? Yes. According to Psalm 34, whom does the angel of the Lord encamp around?
Yeah.
Yes?
The angels of God stand around those who fear.
Yes. In Revelation 8, how many angels were given trumpets? Yes, Jennifer?
Four?
No. Yes, Monica?
Seven.
Yes. Which apostle was rescued by an angel the night before he was due to stand trial? Yes? Yes. Who struggled with an angel and overcame him? Yes? Yes? Yes. What happened to the meat and unleavened bread which the angel told Gideon to place on the altar?
Can you repeat the question?
What happened to the meat and unleavened bread which the angel told Gideon to place on the altar? Yes?
It was burned with fire.
Yes. What animals had their mouths shut by an angel in the book of Daniel? Yes, Jennifer? Yes. What did the angel that Balaam saw have in his hand? Yes? Yes. Which of the Gospels is the only one not to mention angels?
Quartet, and the song is "Angels We Have Heard on High."
Thank you.
presentation for today will be Jacob, and he's going to be sharing with us about angels in heaven.
Good afternoon. What heavenly music. Many years ago, Sister Ellen White was leading out at a prayer meeting at St. Helena, North California. As she often did when speaking, she had chosen a hymn appropriate to the topic of her presentation that evening. For some reason, when the congregation stood to sing, their hearts were just not in the words they were mouthing. They sang listlessly, without any feeling, just like some congregations still do today. Sister White held up her hand to stop them. She said, "I have heard the angels sing. They do not sing as you are singing tonight. They sing with reverence. Their heart is in their expressions of song. They sing with meaning. Now let's try again and see if we can put our hearts into the singing of this song." It's been reported that when the congregation started to sing again, they put real feeling into the hymn she had chosen. Through the 70 years of her ministry, Sister White heard the angels sing a number of times in vision. In fact, in a vision given her in 1850, she was even allowed to sing with the angels. She wrote, "Then I was pointed to the glory of heaven, to the treasure laid up for the faithful. Everything was lovely and glorious. The angels would sing a lovely song, then they would cease singing and take their crowns from their heads and cast them glittering at the feet of the lovely Jesus. And with melodious voices cried, 'Glory, Alleluia.' I joined with them in their songs of praise and honor to the Lamb, and every time I opened my mouth to praise Him, I felt an unutterable sense of glory that surrounded me. It was a far more unexceeding and eternal weight of glory," said the angel. "The little remnant who love God and keep His commandments and are faithful to the end will enjoy this glory and ever be in the presence of Jesus and sing with the holy angels." Sister White also wrote, "Oh, what music! There is not an inharmonious note. Every voice proclaims, 'Worthy is the Lamb that was slain.'" She was shown the order, the perfect order of heaven, and wrote how inapterable she was as she listened to the perfect music in heaven. In vision, she saw companies of angels standing in a hollow square, everyone having a harp of gold. There is one angel who always leads, who touches the harp and strikes the note. Then all join in the rich, perfect music of heaven. She wrote, "It cannot be described. It is melody, heavenly, divine. Let's always remember to sing with real feeling and try to learn to sing the songs of Zion here on this earth so that one day we can join the angel choir in heaven."
Thank you, Jacob, for sharing that presentation with us. And now you all remember to sing with feeling next when we sing. And speaking of singing, we now have the second youth song, which is called "What Heavenly Music."
The voice of
So we've come to the final item of our young people's meeting today, and that is the group singing Back Footsteps.
This song, written about 13 years ago, asks for the protection during the night and guidance of the Lord during the day. And at this time, we would like to call upon those that will help in singing this song.